exhaust and force everybody to come downstairs, who's upstairs. So we have a built-in audience. There are several tax bills that passed. The long history of this is in 2008, my colleague, Councilwoman Fiona Sanchez, and I started trying to figure out how to create a tax system that encourages investment in the city and that helps manufacturers and other sectors that have typically low margins that are at a huge competitive disadvantage just because of the fact that they're in the city limits instead of being outside the city limits. After about 2 years of pretty extensive research and work with the Revenue Department and others, we put together charts of how changing the tax code would affect different industries, played games with what the gross receipts rate could be, the net income tax would be, and we concluded that the best thing that could happen to the city of Philadelphia is the elimination of the net income tax. We're one of only 5 cities in the country with a net income tax. It's 6.45% of your profit. If you're located in the city, it's 6.45% of almost all of your profit. There are some rules about allocations and other things that are complicated, but suffice it to say, if you're a developer, if you're in the software sector, if you're in the tech space, it's probably 6.45% of 100% of your profit if you're here. That causes people to, once they become profitable, not want to be here in the city. As a consequence, we have shiny glass buildings on the other side of City Line Avenue, Apple Contrahop, and other places. We've had a large number of manufacturers over the years still be manufacturers, but either outside the city or in Alabama, other places that moved out here to get away from our tax structure. We were not able to get a bill passed eliminating the net income tax. The other cities that have a net income tax are Washington, D.C., and New York, which are the world's political and financial capitals. And we're in esteemed company, Columbus and Detroit. So really, Washington, D.C., and New York are outliers. They can charge whatever taxes they want because people will be there because of what they are. Philadelphia, is not an outlier. We're strategically located in the heart of the Northeastern Corridor, right between those two financial and political capitals. But we can't take advantage of it as a city because of our tax structure that punishes profitability. And it's so easy to take advantage of the benefits of the city just by being on the other side of the county line that many people do. Or if they don't, they live downtown and they still use their parents' address so that they don't have to pay those taxes. Or they have an address outside of town even though they do all of their business in the city. It's too easy to escape a tax because of the county line. We also don't have something called unitary reporting in Pennsylvania, which means you can avoid taxes, so it's very unfair that the companies are here, very disadvantageous that the companies are in Philadelphia because you can legally avoid taxation through something called the Delaware loophole. So if you don't have property plant equipment here, other things that we can tie you to taxation, you can basically escape most of Philadelphia's taxes, and it's Philadelphia companies that don't take advantage of the Delaware loophole that are paying the heavy tax burden. Looking at all that, we decided to eliminate the net income tax. We decided to pay for it by increasing the gross receipts tax to 0.5 from 0.15 mils. That is, or 5 mils from 1.5 mils. That is about 0.5% of your gross. We said, what about low margin businesses? How do we adjust for that? And we put in place a bunch of criteria for low margin businesses that allow some wholesalers, retailers, et cetera, to have essentially a net receipts tax after cost of goods, cost of labor, and things like that, which is at a higher rate. But that essentially our goal was to completely level the playing field between businesses in Philadelphia and businesses outside of Philadelphia. So that whether you were here, or whether you were located in Montgomery County or Russia, you paid the same taxes to the city of Philadelphia. The only taxes you paid are for goods you sold in the city of Philadelphia, and you would pay no taxes for goods you sold outside of the city of Philadelphia. What that meant was every manufacturer that's currently here would be on the same exact level playing field as every manufacturer everywhere else in the world. Manufacturers in Philadelphia don't sell most of their product in Philadelphia. So essentially, we were significantly lowering taxes in an area where there are still good salaries and benefits, and we hopefully could rely on manufacturing growth, especially in the green tech sector, which has been a push of this administration. We've got what's going on at the Navy Yard as an example of how that is existing in a tax-free zone in Philadelphia. It could exist in neighborhoods in the city that truly need those jobs if we were to make this change. Long story short, there's a compromise. And the compromise is that we were able to achieve essentially the tax benefits for people who sell goods and manufacturers in the city by going to something called, by leaving in place that income tax, but going to something called single sales factor. And what single sales factor allows us to do is to almost level the playing field between people who are located in the city and people who are located outside the city by applying, you will still pay net income tax on your sales in Philadelphia and gross receipts tax on your sales in Philadelphia, but most of your sales, if you're in those sectors, are not in the city, and so it significantly removes the disadvantage. It doesn't eliminate it from being in the city. We're able to do this. It cost the city some money over the course of the five-year plan, and we worked very hard with the Governor administration to accomplish this, and through great cooperation, I'm very pleased that we were able to do that. The other thing that was an important part of Councilwoman Señora Sanchez and my bill was to eliminate all taxes for businesses on the first $100,000. That's gross receipts and net income. In the final bill that passed, we did achieve that. T will go through the details of what year that happens and everything else, but for every business, I think starting in 2015, 2016, somewhere out there, you will not pay any gross receipts tax or any net income tax on your first $100,000 in income. And we hope that that will keep people in the city, inspire, you know, I mean, for this community, I think that's very meaningful for consultants, developers, other people who are in the tech space who are paid on 1099s. It essentially eliminates their business taxes. This was 3 years of work. We're very proud of it, and we were very pleased to be able to work with the administration. The work is not done. In my view, we still have to eliminate the income tax and find a way to pay for it if we can't reach agreement on increasing the gross receipts rate. But you know, we will continue to work on that, push for it, and. You know, I'm very hopeful that in the next 3 or 4 years, we'll be able to actually accomplish the gradual elimination of the net income tax over a period of years is how we're going to have to do it. You know, to eliminate it over 10 years would be roughly $28 million a year. But I think in a $3.5 billion a year budget, we can find that, and we believe that it will create more opportunities and more jobs than it will cost the city. People know that that tax relief is coming. That's all I have to say. I'm going to let T give you the details of the various tax bills. There are other significant bills introduced by colleagues of mine that were co-sponsored by Councilwoman Sanchez and others that eliminate the business privilege tax for the first 2 years of new companies. That was originally in the bill that Maria Sanchez and I introduced. We were told by the law department that that was not legal. But when it was introduced by a different council person, it was legal. And so those things happen. But it's a great bill, and it's great law, and hopefully it'll cause you guys to start companies here and keep them here and a lot of other people. Thank you for allowing us to come out and talk to you today. On your chairs, you'll see something for Philly C. If you know education entrepreneurs, if you know people who are working in the education space, there's a lot of former Teach for America teachers here and others. This will be a crowdsourced event where people will pick among emerging entrepreneurs and established entrepreneurs for various prizes. They will be the people presenting with ideas for entrepreneurs in the education space. Will have the opportunity to either meet with VCs, meet with foundations and potential funders, and they'll be presenting to a group of potential clients. So there's principals from charter schools, from public schools. There's people that are on the board of various significant charter schools in the city that will be there. And you know, there's the opportunity to not just get a little bit of seed money, not just get a legal advisor or other things, but potentially sell yourself to a customer. And if you know people that are education entrepreneurs or have great ideas about how to keep kids in school or how to tutor them after school or things that aren't currently being done right now that could be done better, please pass the word on and start. Once again, thank you for your time.